Good morning, Great Peace.
Good morning.
Nobody but you. Would you please stand and join us in our congregational song?
Trust is in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Verse 11 ends by saying, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. May the Lord have a blessing upon the readers and the hearers and doers of his word. Psalm 32 in its entirety.
Let us pray. O Lord, our Lord. O Lord, our Lord. O Lord, how wonderful is thy name. We come this morning, Lord God, to say thank you. Lord, we thank you for just being God all by yourself. Amen. Lord, you know we've always, Lord, looked to you, the author and the finisher of our faith. This morning, Father, we just want to say thank you for allowing us to be able to wake up and see another day. Lord, a day that wasn't promised to us. But Lord, you let us to wake up and let us see. Yes. And because of your grace and your mercy,
yes, Lord. Yes,
Lord. Lord, we are able to come back into the house of prayer one more time.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
We just want to say thank you this morning, Father God.
Thank you.
Because you brought us from such a mighty, mighty long way.
Yes.
Lord, we realize that if it had not been for you who were on our side, Lord, we would have been totally consumed.
Yes.
But Lord, because of your grace and your mercy, Lord, we can say, I look to the hills, from hence cometh my help.
Yes.
And I know that my help comes from the Lord.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you this morning for giving us a reasonable portion of health and strength.
Thank you.
We're not as strong as we used to be. We're not spry like we used to be. But Lord, we thank you that we are able to put one foot ahead of the other one.
Yes, sir.
Father, we just want to say thank you for allowing us to be able to move from the bed to the floor. Sometimes it gets difficult. You understand the bones that sometimes are aching. You understand, oh God, the weariness sometimes.
Yes, Lord.
But Lord, this morning we know that thou art our strength.
Yes.
And we just come to say thank you.
Thank you.
We thank you for blessing our families, Lord.
Yes.
Because we're living in times where because you leave home, that doesn't mean that you're going to make it back home.
Yeah.
And Lord, we just want to say thank you.
Thank
for
you.
Your grace and for your mercy.
Yeah.
Dear Lord, this morning, we lift up our sick to you this morning.
Yeah.
You know them name by name and place by place.
Yeah.
Touch them right now, Father. Let them know, Father, that you are still in the healing business.
Yeah.
For we know, God, that you are able this morning. Because a woman who crawled through a crowd, having an issue of blood for 12 long years, touched the hem of your garment. Lord, at that moment she was made whole. We thank you, Lord, for your healing power. Touch us right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. Then, oh God, we lift up the angels of this house, Father God. Touch him this morning, dear Heavenly Father. Touch his family. Bless them, Lord, as you see them standing in the need. Then, oh Lord, we pray for the man who will stand and break the bread of life. Lord, crown him with wisdom and knowledge. Take away any fright. Take away any nervousness. Because, Lord, we know that you're able. Then, oh God, help us to live according to your word. Help us to live in such a way that if the trumpet shall sound, Lord, this night, Lord, we know that we have a place somewhere in your kingdom where we can praise your name forever and forever. Lord, this is our prayer. Have mercy upon us this morning, Father. Have mercy upon the sinner man and the sinner woman that know you not in the pardoning of their sin. Father, let us be a light that they might see that there is truly a reality in serving a true and living God. Then, O Lord, we'll be ever careful to praise and lift up your name. In the precious name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, we ask these blessings. And the sweet Holy Ghost, amen.
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 Good morning.
Good morning.
I stand on behalf of our pastor, Reverend Moland, and our church family here at Great Peace Missionary Baptist Church. And as our practice has been on the first Sunday of the month, it's time to recognize those of you who celebrate your birthdays in the month of July. You're in that category, we're going to ask you to please stand. If you're able to, if not, raise your hand. Our ushers will accommodate you and give you a birthday card. Then we will sing happy birthday to you.
Amen.
Will you please stand if you're in that category?
Amen.
It's another day journey.
Thank you, Sister Nelson. Thank you, Sister John. Thank you, Brother Gilmore. And good morning to everyone. I want to thank Minister West for that message on last Sunday.
Amen.
Thank you, Great Peace, for what you are continuing to do, what you have already done, and what you agree that you will do in the future when it comes to the ministry. Now, let me say this for all. We've had some unite with us. And normally on the first Sunday, we give the right hand of fellowship. But I think we're going to forego that for a little longer, for it's coming up shaking hands. Amen, is that all right?
Amen.
But I want you to know, new members, those who are present now, in the future, that you are welcome at Great Peace.
Amen.
Amen. Now, I know we just sang, because I wasn't singing, I think I'm just listening, happy birthday, but we have one young sister that I know of in this church, who not only born in the month of July, she was born on the 4th of July. Sister Marlo, I see you back there. She is a 4th of July child. And her sister, I believe, born in, yeah, she was standing born in the month of July, right? Yeah, okay. My goodness. Sister Marlo, would you stand, please, just for a moment? One of the fourth of July. So tomorrow you are standing because I have an accolade to give unto you at this particular time. Being a college-bound student, and others have recognized your academic achievement. And you have been awarded a scholarship from the Good Old Western General Association. And let me say, congratulations. Look forward, did you know about that already?
I did not.
Oh! I said, I just want to surprise them this morning. We talked this morning, but I should have been let the cat out of the bag. I haven't spoken to some smart one, but I still didn't let the cat out of the bag. Now I want everybody to know that she did receive a scholarship from the association. And I don't know this to be absolutely accurate, but I'm assuming that she is one of the only persons who sent in those applications. Yeah. But who passed out, I believe, by, but that's the one they received. So your diligence paid off. So keep it up while you're in school, all right?
Amen.
Amen. It will pay off. Amen. I want to ask that you continue to lift up the Magruder family in prayer. Most of you know now that his brother went on the other day. And so let's continue to pray for them. Do we have any first timers in this forum? First timers? This is your first time being at Great Peace.
Amen.
I know we have one because I have a card. But your hand, that's why I couldn't tell. Okay. We welcome you this morning.
Amen.
Man.
I have a visitor.
Yes, amen. Oh, okay. Yeah, well, you're not a first time, but you visit with me today. Yeah, all right. Now. Welcome this morning. Matter of fact, we welcome all of you.
Amen.
In the name of our Lord and our Savior, who is none other than Jesus the Christ. We thank God for all that He has done, He is doing, and will continue to do. May the Spirit lead us in our worship this morning as we praise, honor our God, our Lord, our Savior, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, this day I believe that Minister Gadson has agreed to, and we preachers like to say, break the bread of life. Thank God for these preachers. I have never asked one to come and share with us, and they said, no, I don't Thank God I'll be able to live to have one ten. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for your consistency and your faithfulness in ministry.
Amen.
We just offer time. Let's sit down. This time we will honor the Lord through our giving. And he tells us in his word how we are to give, not out of necessity, not out of some burden that someone else has put upon you to give, but give according to how he has blessed you. You know, that's the best way to do it,
sir.
And if you appreciate how he has blessed you, you're going to appreciate how he will lead you in giving.
Amen.
Amen. Father, we do thank you now.
Lord.
We glorify your name. We praise you. We honor you. We adore you. Father, we thank you for this privilege of being steward in your work here on earth. Thank you for using us now. Lord, we ask your blessing upon those who will come now and share out of the abundance of what you have blessed them with. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Please stand. Y'all recognize your presence in the room.
Yeah.
Sing your song, brother.
It's 4:55. 475 in A and 455 in B, Babel and Retort. We'll just do one verse in the chorus.
Give this message with me just giving the message and you being the leader.
Yes.
as I go through. I pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
When I joined Great Peace, I began a Christian friendship with one of the ministers here, and that was Minister Willie Stephens. The many conversations we shared were often about the Word of God. However, about 8 months before his death, about 8 months before his death, the focus of our conversation changed. Minister Stephens' focus became more and more about getting to know God.
Amen.
Now, during those months we discussed getting to know God, I began to notice a change in my life as well. I began to wonder if I knew God the way that he knew God. Now, in my quest to determine if I knew God, I soon realized that you cannot fully know God if you do not know Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And I want to say at this point that the pastor has given me an opportunity to preach two sermons in the series. This one is To Know God. Next Sunday will be To Know Jesus. So during my conversations with Minister Stephens during the last 8 months of his life, I discovered that there is a fine line between knowing about God and getting to know God. Most of my life has been dedicated to knowing things about God and his word. But I now know that a deeper relationship with God can be achieved when I get to know God. I'm aware that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are one. But it's impossible to fully understand the difference between all three without getting to know all three. Getting to know God is, in my opinion, a process that we must go through to get to know God. First of all, that process, you must know God. You must, in order to know God, his word. You must know his word as well. Now, when you prayerfully read the Bible, over time you will gain knowledge of God because God himself will reveal himself to you. But what if a person does not know God at all? How can they gain knowledge of God? God has provided numerous ways for us to know who he is. And some of those ways I will mention now. God can be revealed to us through nature. When one views the universe and all its wonders, a question will eventually arise, asking how or what caused this and who was responsible for it, the creation that is. Psalm 19, chapter verse 1 through 4 has an answer for that. And it reads, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the works of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They have no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into the depth, into the earth, their words to the end of the world." Now, these verses show that language is not a barrier to understanding who created the word. Because the problem is, it says that it's silently spoken. The universe itself speaks. Nature itself speaks to us. We don't know. If we don't care, the voice of the nature speaks to us. And these words in the verse says that the heavens declare the glory of God. But the heavens do not speak words to anyone. The heavens go about their work each and every day without saying a word. And if you listen to what the words are saying, then you don't need to have a language barrier or nothing like that, because it speaks for itself. Now, we can also be, God can be revealed to us through physical revelation. God can physically reveal himself to us. For example, Pharaoh told Moses he did not know the God of Moses. God revealed himself to Pharaoh in 9 separate occasions, and he would not let Israel go. But on the 10th plague, when all the firstborn in Egypt, including his firstborn, Pharaoh realized that he was no match for the power of God, and he ordered Israel to leave. Now, God can also be revealed through word of mouth. God directed Israel to teach each succeeding generation about him. And they did not do this, and they suffered the consequences. God instructed Moses to tell the children of Israel the following in Deuteronomy, the 6th chapter, verses 5 through 7. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be your being on your heart. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you are at home, and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. Now, there's another way that God can be revealed, and that is God can be revealed through reputation. God also reveals himself through his own actions. Rahab helped the Jewish spies because she had heard that God would give them their land, the land of Israel. And this is what she said in Joshua, the 2nd chapter, verses 9 through 11. She said, and said to them, I know that the Lord has given you this land, and that a great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in the land in this country are melting in fear of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the Red Sea, and for you when you crossed over into Egypt. And this is what she was saying. She said, I know about this. God revealed this to them. They had seen the actions of God, and now they are beginning to witness what God can do. Yeah. And she is seeing what he will be doing. Now, some may think that it is possible to search the variety of technologies, systems available today to find out how to know and accept God. Now, I don't deny that you can search the scriptures using technology, but man's technology will not in itself reveal God to anyone. You see, man is not revealed to God, because God created man and knows all about him already. No man knows all about God, because God has to reveal himself to each and every one. God is always near us, but we are not always near him. If you want to know God, you cannot find him in outer space. We cannot discover God as the way Columbus discovered America. God is not the force, and Satan is not the dark side, even though he represents darkness from the movie Star Wars. No one of his own knowledge can get to know God. Now, I have already said God must reveal himself to us if we are to get to know him. But God created us in such a way that we have everything we need to get to know God. Genesis 1st chapter, verse 26, as I've already read, gives us that information that we need. Genesis 1:26 explains the things God gave to Adam and the whole human race that is necessary to get to know God. Now, Dr. Charles Stanley points out in his Life's Application Bible that there is only one God, but he expresses himself through three persons of the Trinity. Within the eternal fellowship of the Trinity, the members of the Godhead have always enjoyed a deep, rich, and unbroken relationship of love with each other. Now, when God created us, he wanted us to have a measure of that unbroken relationship of love one for another. Now, creating us to reflect his own image, he makes it possible for us to develop a deep and intimate relationship with him if we desire to do that. Irenaeus was a leading Christian theologian from the second century who stated that God created us in his image because creating us in his image was a way to create in us freedom and reason. Creating in us likeness also allows us to communicate with God. You see, man is the only one of God's creation that can communicate with him. All the animals and everything cannot speak to God, pray to God. They only act on instinct. We can communicate with God physically. And we fail to do it quite often, even though we have that ability. Now, when we pray to God, we are communicating with him to express our thoughts, wishes, desires, and problems. Likewise, God can communicate with us to express himself. Creating mankind in his likeness was a way to create in man both freedom and reason. This ability gives us the power to make our own decisions to serve or not to serve God himself. Again, Charles Stanley says that God helps us to grasp his word, not merely so that we can amass an impressive body of religious knowledge about him, but that we can know, love, and enjoy the Lord of the universe who created us and has a wonderful purpose for our lives if we accept his understanding of us and his commandments. Now, you and I cannot use today's technology marvels to find God. Isaiah 4, the 40th chapter, verse 18 says that God is incomprehensible. He says, with whom? When will we compare God? With whom will we compare God? To know to what image will you liken him? You see, God is impossible to understand or comprehend because he is not like us. His ways are not our ways. So God reveals himself to us, and that makes him incomprehensible. He has the will to do that. He has the will. He is the one that reveals himself to us. We cannot on our own understand God. We have to search God's word and ask the Holy Spirit to guide us in our search to understand his word. And when we understand his word, then we can go to the next level to understand about God. Now, earlier I said that Minister Stephens and I discovered how one can get to know God during the last 8 months of his life. But I want you to know that in order for me to have participated in Minister Stephens' discussions about how to know God, I had to already know about God myself. Knowledge about God involves studying God's word with the aid of the Holy Spirit. But early on in my discussion with my friend, Minister Stephens, I now realize from those discussions that his position on understanding how to know God had transitioned from merely wanting to know more about God and his word to a state that focused on how to get to know God himself, have an intimate relationship with God. Now, at this point in his life, I believe that he was focused not so much on knowing God, but getting to know God. because he was focused on heaven itself and not focused on heaven on earth. Now, often as I have listened to my friends speak on how to become intimate with God, I remember a series of questions I asked God about before I accepted my call to ministry. I recall that I asked God if he had made a mistake in calling me to preach. Because first of all, I am not a charismatic person. I don't speak well sometimes. My skills are not those of a typical Baptist preacher. I asked God if he really wanted me to preach the gospel with so few qualifications. The answer I received was not the answer I wanted to hear. I was told to accept the call and to preach and teach the gospel and not worry about my qualifications. I realize now that my qualifications don't matter because God has the power to do all things. But as I had opportunities to preach the message from my peers, and as they would tell me, you know, it's kind of a strange thing when you're preaching the word and you hear God and God tells you one thing and your friends tell you something else. You have a tendency to want to listen to the friends. And the friends can lead you astray. Now, they said I always had a good message, but I needed to move it up to a notch. They said, you need to include some kind of pooping in your service. Now, to be honest, I tried doing it, but I never could concur. I never could succeed at it. And I came to the conclusion that it wasn't meant for me. Again, I asked the Lord if he still wanted me to continue preaching, because all the advice I received indicated that I would not get very far preaching if I didn't move. And I kept thinking about that. And I asked the Lord numerous times what he wanted me to do with my preaching. And the Lord stopped telling me anything about it. Now, when I say the Lord stopped talking to me, some people might look at me and say, yeah, the Lord spoke to you. But you will never hear the Lord speak to you unless you get to know him. You get closer to him. When you get closer to him, you realize that the Holy Spirit indwells within you, and he can tell you things. And when he tells you those things, you know that it's who it's from. So I'm cautious in telling people that this is what the Lord told me, but I know that the Lord speaks to me. The Holy Spirit is there. And I put my trust in the Holy Spirit. Now, the Spirit, one day, as I said, the Lord stopped talking to me about this. I kept praying about it, and I never got an answer. And this wasn't over a week or two. This was over years. Several years. As a matter of fact, it wasn't until about 3 years ago that I got the indication that what I was to do was what he wanted me to do. And he told me why he wanted me to do that. I was told that God had enough pooping preachers already. I was told that the Lord's plan for me was to preach to those that cannot relate to pooping, those that have problems with pooping. They need a word from God in a softer manner. I was told that every sermon the Holy Spirit gave me was meant for me, for someone out there in the audience. I was told I did not need to know who that person or person was. My job was to preach the message God gave. Then the Spirit provided me with an example I had after some of my sermons some years ago to provide me with, this is what I want you to do and this is the truth. I'm giving you the final answer. Don't ask me about it anymore. I had given a sermon once when I was years, about 7 years ago, and I had been preaching for about 7 years. And a week after that sermon, a young man came to me. I remember seeing him out there in the audience when I had the pews out there in the audience when I was speaking. And he had an Asian wife. And he came up to me, and he was African American. And he came up to me after church, and he approached me, and he thanked me for the message that I had preached. And I said, what are you thanking me for? I was wondering why he was thanking me. And he said, my wife really wants to believe in God and learn about prayer, but she has a problem with all of the preaching, with the hooping and all of that. She says, she couldn't get to understand that. But he said that when you preach that word, she could understand it because it was from the word and all of the other accessories. Now, I'm not talking about hooping. I'm just telling you what the Lord told me. And those that hoop, the Lord probably told them to do so. I am just basically expressing what the Lord told me. And as I said, I know that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, talked to me and told me those things. So this man told me that she was glad to hear me preach and that she could understand the message. So at that time, since that time, I have been preaching for about 7 years or so. And all 7 of those years, I would ask the Lord why he asked me to preach the word, because I didn't think I had the qualifications. So you see, for 7 years, I was preaching, and then this individual came up to me and told me that, and then for about 7 more years, sit down and waiting for the Lord to tell me why he wanted me to preach in the way that I did. Now, as I said, all I have to say this: the Lord will answer anyone's prayers.
Yes, he will.
But he does it in his own time, and not our time.
Come on, preacher.
And he provides a final answer to the questions we present to him.
Amen.
And that is a final answer. You don't have to go back. You can go back to him, but he'll do just like I did in the first place. Since you've been talking all this, I've told you. And you don't have to mention it again, all right? Listen the first time and leave it at that. But you cannot rush the Lord's answer by constantly asking him these questions. Now, I have known God and about God for most of my life. But God chose an 8-month period in my life to teach me about how to know God. The Lord did so through discussions with my dear friend, Minister Stephens. Now, all his discussions reminded me of how Elijah must have felt as he listened to Elijah before he was taken up. Now, I did not ask for a double portion of Minister Stephens' spirit, but I was given a double portion of God's understanding who God is. Now, these discussions were blessings to me because those discussions moved me to a higher plane in understanding God. I already understood God, but God clarified some of the things, the questions that were in my mind. You know, those cloudy areas that you have and you say, I wonder about this, I wonder about that, but I don't wonder about that anymore. That is over. I'm going to do the will of God. I'm going to preach in the way he said that I should. I'm not worried about moving.
Amen.
Because he's already told me, it's not for you. Now, when I look at my life and think about all the things that I've done in my life since God called me to preach, he created in me his likeness to allow me to always communicate with him if I want to know him. God created in me an understanding needed to realize that before God can reveal any intimate things about himself to me, I must continue to seek his face. Psalms 27:8 will always be a part of my prayer to the Lord, which says, my heart says to you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. I will seek his face, not just in the songs sometimes, but in all times. Not just in the good times and the short times, the great things and all of those things. To know about God requires spending time in prayer, communicating with him and asking for understanding on how to know him. Now, to know him is different than basically knowing about him, because to know him has an intimate relationship that says you are far better off knowing what he's in. God has revealed these things to you. And this is not something that he revealed to me. He can reveal it to any of you. If you want to know God. Now, we can read the Bible and we can study it, but if we really want to get intimate with God, we've got to communicate with God. Ask him what he wants us to do. Talk to him and say, not the big things and the little things, all of the things that are occurring in our lives. Our lives are filled with all kinds of things, good things, bad things, and the little things and the big things. But God has an answer for them all. All we have to do is to seek his face and ask him for an understanding of all of that. Now, as I said, requiring to know God requires spending time in prayer, communicating with him, and asking for understanding on how to know him. I realized that once I communicated my prayers to know him, that is all I can do, because he will provide answers to prayers in his own time, and he will base my request to know him on how much and how close and how much I serve him. I cannot say, ask God for this, and then I don't do his will. It's a two-way street. And God controls the stoplight. When I accepted that I was to follow the Lord's original words to me, to preach and to teach the gospel, and not worry so much about how I delivered the message, I was making a very important step in getting to know God. Abraham accepted God's word to leave his family and move to a foreign land. Because Abraham believed in God and followed his commands, God counted him as righteous. And this, my Christian friends, is my sermon. I believe it was given to me by the Holy Spirit. That is what he gave me. I don't want to do any more, because that would be out of bounds of what the Holy Spirit gave me. So I don't want to add it. I don't want to subtract it. I just want to do exactly what was given to me. Heavenly Father, I am indeed thankful for you going with me through this message. Thanking you for, Lord, allowing me to see the message and be able to read it. Because I know when I got up this morning, it was rather fuzzy. But I asked you to help me to read it, Lord. And you did that. I thank you for all that you've done for me. I pray that each and every one that's here today gets something from this message. Because, not because I said it, because it allows them, if they can understand you just a little bit better. The closer you get to God, makes this life a lot easier as you go through each and every day. I thank you and I pray. And this is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, to get to know God requires a step. That is, God has said that we need to accept Jesus.
Amen.
And Lord and Savior. And Jesus said, I am the way. No man comes to the Father.
No man. No man.
I already told you that they are all, the Trinity is basically one in love and everything. They work together. There's nothing that they disagree on. And if that is what the word says about Jesus, then that's what I go with. And you cannot get to see Jesus or be with Jesus in heaven unless you accept it while you're here on earth. I can't rely on anybody else to get me into heaven but myself. Others can pray for me, but I have to be the one to accept Jesus as my Savior if I want to be with him. So if there is anyone here today that does not know Jesus and would like to accept it, or if you are here and you're visiting and you would like to join in this church, now is the time. Because Jesus died on the cross for you and for me. Individually, we have to accept him. Just because I belong to a Greater Peace Missionary Baptist Church doesn't guarantee me a seat in heaven. Just because my parents were church goers and the religious believers, doesn't same thing for me. Each and every one of us has to earn our way to heaven. But in earning our way to heaven, it doesn't cost us anything. Now, we sometimes get leery of something being free. We always say nothing's free. And accepting Jesus is free, but you have an obligation after you accept Jesus. So at this time, if there be one, if you will stand, if there be one that would like to accept Jesus for the first time, because he is the only way. We worry about the things on this earth, but we really should be worried about when we leave this earth, because life is different. It will be total. It will be eternal. If you're not in Jesus when you leave here, it is a fiery situation. If you will, please come.
355 today, and 233 to me. 355 and 233. Lead me, God.
Lord,
church, Pastor, and ministers of the Pope that
God bless you.
We had our last auxiliary meeting, be a comment, Pastor. I don't know if it's an epidemic in Greater Peace, but I'm getting ready to have cataract surgery on Tuesday. So I asked for prayer. My doctor is praying. Christian man, he calls on the phone, praying on the phone. So I know I'm a good answer. I just ask him to pray for me.
Amen. Good morning. Avery and I just wanted to thank y'all very much for praying for us. We appreciate your love and support.
Sister Dominguez, you said pray for you want prayer for your niece.
My niece.
For your niece?
Passed away last night.
I think we ought to always pray for those that are requesting prayer.
Amen. Amen.
And so at this time.
Just before the brother offers a prayer, I want to good morning, Greater Peace. And thank you for the message, Brother Gadson. I want to clarify something about the brother. I have had six brothers. So Jesse was a patriarch of the family. And so that's going to leave four of us, because we already had one to go on. The brother that you had been praying for, Dwayne, he's in Detroit, Michigan, and doing well. And so I particularly want to thank the Sunday School, the Brotherhood, and all of the Greater Peace, because they always ask me, how's Dwayne? Dwayne is doing fine. Dwayne is the one who died on the operating table three times. And he's doing well right now. So keep praying for his spiritual progress. But Jesse is the one who brought us here to Texas. He was the soldier. And that's how my sister, my oldest sister, and I got out here. And that's why I'm at Greater Peace, is because Jesse brought us out here. And he went on home. He lost a lung 2 weeks ago. And then they moved him to a hospice, and he went on home in glory. And Jesse, very special young man, very special young man. But I'm asking prayer now, because you guys know how these things go.
Oh, yes.
When it comes to putting away a loved one. So
yes.
I'm asking for some prayer.
Thank you.
That God continue to work, and that God gets the glory.
Yes.
Not only from his death, his life,
oh,
but from his death.
Yes, sir.
Y'all do that for me?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Very familiar with that because I'm still recuperating from it myself. But I know that you can bring through this and that it will turn out okay if you're there. We know that you can do it. You're there for it. The doctors, you will guide them. Well, that is our prayer, that you will guide each and every one of them. And Lord, we are praying, Lord, that you go, Sister Reed, we ask as well. As she came forth to thank us and all of that. We know that there's always a need, regardless of what we have, and we just ask that you would go with them.
Yes.
And again, Lord, we're praying for Minister McGruder's brother.
Yes.
And we pray that the family will be comforted at this time.
Yes.
The world will keep on going, and they will never meet except for those that have lost a loved one.
Yes.
When you've lost everything about you seems to stop and go in slow motion because you have lost a loved one. And when you lose a loved one, that's something that's good. You cannot explain at the time, and you will not be able to explain it throughout your lifetime. But Lord, I ask for comfort for the family that you died for. And these are the things that I'm praying for you because I know that you can fulfill them if you can. And this is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Minister Gadson, for that message today.
Amen.
I don't know why y'all picked up on that, but Minister Gadson was so transparent in his speaking, preaching.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. He just tells it like it is.
Amen.
He made it clear now, but you understand this too. Being clear that he had nothing against the hoop back there, but you just pointed out. The hoop was there. You just pointed out, but that's not the route he's supposed to take. Now y'all understand why I don't mind getting up saying that I wasn't called to sing. Okay, you understand that now. Do what you do best and just go on and let it go. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Again, thank you, Minister Gadson. Now it is time for us to observe the Lord's Supper. And I pray that each of you has a cup. Some say no. Some are saying no about the cup. Am I right? Y'all are saying no?
Raise your hand.
Well, somebody put a gift in. I mean, y'all saying no, hey, we'll get your cup. I have to bring your cup. Amen. Everyone should have a cup of this tank. Just let me say this. We know that Jesus himself established the Lord's Supper. He is the one who put it into place. And Jesus intends for us to observe the Lord's Supper throughout all of our lives, throughout our generations. One thing Jesus did not do, he did not explain nor interpret the meaning of the Lord's Supper until he called this man, the Apostle Paul. He gave him the explanation, the meaning of the Lord's Supper. And we find that, of course, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Sometimes we share those verses. We'll do that today. Let's begin beginning with verse number 23. If you want a rationale, maybe I shouldn't say rationale, but a meaning of the Lord's Supper, Jesus gave it. Not in his earthly ministry, but after he had gone back to glory, he told it to the, revealed it to the Apostle Paul. And Paul, in turn, shared it with the church at Corinth and other places. In verse number 23 of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, for I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. Remember, Paul got this by revelation, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was crucified, in which he was betrayed, rather, took bread. And when he had given thanks, Father, we thank you for the bread, for it points to your broken body. We thank you, Lord, that you gave yourself on that cross.
Yes.
For us.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord, that you shed your holy, righteous, precious blood.
Yes.
For us. You had us in mind all the time.
Right.
And we say thank you for
it.
And then you gave us this memorial observance to observe throughout our Christian life. And then you gave us a reason why you wanted to do it. Verse 24. And when he had given thanks, picking up the bread, if you don't already have it, I can cut, go ahead. Thanking everyone had it out daily. If you're not like me, it takes me so long to uncover this cup. I have a hard time getting between those two things to get the bread. I'm just being transparent, that's all. He took the bread, he broke it, and he said through the Apostle Paul, as he had spoken to his disciples, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. And he tells us why, that he wants us to take and eat it. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as often as ye drink it in what? Remembrance of me. Shall we drink the cup? And read it on just a little further. And verse number 26. For as often as ye eat this bread,
yes,
and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death. And the church is still showing forth his death by observing and participating in the eating of the bread and the drinking of the fruit of the vine. Father, we thank you. We bless you. We honor you. And Lord, thank you for letting us continue to show forth your name.
Yes.
To the world. To whosoever observed us participating in the Lord's Supper.
Yes.
It is a testimony that you came, you bled, you died, and you rose from the dead.
Yes.
We thank you.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Aren't you glad today that the Lord has taken you under his wing and made you to become one of his children? Amen. God sure is good.
Yes, he is.
I mean, he is. We just don't have a, I can't think of any great, dynamic, profound way of saying this, but God is good. Now, if you can improve on that, you go right ahead. You said, he's great, but you can't get around the fact that he's good. You might say that he's superior, but you can't get around the fact that he's good.
Yeah.
Now, do we have anything else before we have to come back? All right, brother.
I hope we're not being out of order, but we have some guests here now. We don't know their names or where they're from.
All right, sir.
Amen.
And he said we have some guests in the sanctuary.
We don't know that. We didn't get their names or where they're from like we normally.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. I see what you're saying.
Yes, sir.
I thought you said you had some guests.
No, sir.
Oh, okay. All right, we have some guests here, and what we always do on Sundays when we have guests. You are a guest, that's right. Your brothers and sisters in Christ. If you don't mind giving us your name, and if you don't mind doing this now, I know it's after the fact. And where you hail from, where you come from, we'd like to hear that. All right. Amen. We'll go to be first.
I'm Sister Tanya Lamont, and I live here in Killeen. I'm visiting Brother and Sister Melvin and Rosie Brown.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Amen.
Praise God.
I'm Brother McIntyre. I'm Edward McIntyre. I'm originally from North Carolina, but I've been living here in Killeen for about a year and a half now. I'm just glad to be here in the house.
Amen. All right. Good to have you with us, sir.
I'm Janelle Thomas, and these are my two granddaughters. And we decided to come and visit the Great Peace today.
Amen.
And three churches that we're going to go to. So, yeah, you were number one. So,
Amen.
We had to go back to number one. I enjoyed the message today. It was real helpful.
Amen.
Now, please say something to the preacher. We need more preachers that will preach the gospel.
Come on, sister. Come on, sister.
let me say that one. Say it loud, sister.
We need more preachers that will preach the gospel.
Yeah.
And I always say the gospel is the gospel. Our soul was really blessed today, and I didn't know that y'all did prayer requests, but I'd like to say something to my son. My son is suffering from pancreatic cancer.
Did you say your son?
My son.
Yes.
He has pancreatic cancer, and they've had a lifeline into St. David's in Austin, and then after he had that surgery, they had put him in St. Luke's Baptist Hospital in San Antonio. But God is a good God.
Amen.
I thank God he's still with us. He's doing better. He's talking stronger and everything. And,
yes, ma'am.
God just prayed for me. His name is Eric Hall. And he's my fourth. I have four sons. And all four of them have faced death. And they have told us to come make funeral arrangements. But God said not so.
And I said, if that's so, if not, gonna be so.
Amen.
Thank you, my sister. And thank you for making that comment that were all your statements, but the comment you made when you need that more preachers who preach the gospel. Amen. Now I can call, because I ain't know who you preaching. But now I feel like hooping them. Lord say hoop.
And she and her sister and all that came down this weekend and they let me know they were coming. And it's been good.
Look at those hats. In the upper, we said, hey, dress right. All right, so yes.
Good afternoon. I'm Vicki Mix Milburn, and I am her oldest niece.
Oldest.
And her favorite.
Yes. They do resemble each other, don't they?
Yeah.
That's all right. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen. We like you.
All right, we don't want to prolong. We don't want to hold you in over there.
Time to go count about new birth.
All right. Necessary.
Yes,
but it's just good to be among the saints.
Yeah. Oh, and in Fort Worth, I'm also a member of the Great Commission Baptist Church.
Wait a minute. And
Great Commission.
Okay. That's a great thing, man. Amen. God bless you. May you go home in peace. May the Lord lead you and direct you, guide you in all that He wants you to do. We're going to ask Minister Gadson to come back. We're working pretty hard today.
Savior, in glory and majesty.